The Sugar Girls. Tales of Hardship, Love and Happiness in Tate and Lyle's East End by Duncan Barrett and Nuala Calvi. Read by Penelope McDonald. Preface. Heading east out of the city of London, just past Poplar and the Isle of Dogs, you'll find the artificial peninsula of Silvertown, a narrow strip of land 2.5 miles long, sandwiched between the Royal Docks and the broad sweep of the Thames. By the mid-20th century, this area was home to a score of factories, from British Oil and cake mills at one end to Henley's cable works at the other. The factories were a major employer, both for people living in the rows of slum houses in Silvertown and those in the surrounding areas north of the docks, Canningtown, Custom House and Plaistow. While the thriving docks provided work for the men in the local community, the factories offered employment for women as well. When working-class girls left school, there were a limited number of options available to them. Dressmaking, service, clerical work perhaps, and, for the vast majority, a job in a factory. With the near full employment that followed the Second World War, most young people could simply take themselves along to a factory of their choice, ask for work and be hired on the spot. If they found they didn't like it there, they could walk out at lunchtime and be taken on somewhere else before tea. Among the most sought-after factories to work at were the two operated by Tate and Lyle, the Plaistow Wharf and Thames refineries at either end of the Sugar Mile. So called because, in addition to the sugar and syrup they produced, Kayla's jam factory was also located there. Tate and Lyle offered the best wages, generous bonuses 3 times a year, and a social life that was unrivalled in the neighbourhood thanks to the Tate Institute, a subsidised bar and entertainment hall. Unsurprisingly, the company inspired fierce loyalty among its employees. Many young men and women working there in the post-war years were the fourth generation of their families to do so. There were plenty of positions for young sugar girls, thanks to the many female-dominated departments. The great sugar packing operation known as the Hesser Floor, the Blue Room, where the sheets of paper were printed for the sugar bags, and the can-making and syrup-filling floors where the tins of Lyle's Golden Syrup were put together and filled. The jobs could be heavy, exhausting and repetitive, but for the women who undertook them, the rewards outweighed the hardships. Most stayed until they married or fell pregnant. The rules varied between departments as to when they were forced to leave. Nearly all of them looked back on their time at the factories as a kind of golden era in their lives, of independence, friendship and romance, before the responsibilities of marriage and motherhood took over. Originally, the two refineries had been run by rival companies. Henry Tate, a Liverpool grocer turned sugar magnate, put up his London factory in 1877, when much of Silvertown was still marshland. His great business adversary was Abram Lyle, who built his own sugar and syrup factory a mile upstream 4 years later. Lyle was a pious Scot, whose ruddy cheeks belied his commitment to teetotalism. He once declared he would rather see a son of his carried home dead than drunk. For many decades, the two firms competed in sugar production, but with an important unspoken agreement. The Lyles would not encroach on Tate's trademark cubed sugar, while the Tates would not produce a single drop of the golden syrup the Lyles had invented. But a Cold War developed between them, and when the Lyles heard rumours that the Tates were about to launch a syrup onto the market, they hastily knocked together a cube plant in response. Leaking word of its existence was enough to ensure that it never had to be used. The families were scrupulous in keeping up professional boundaries. Although the senior Tates and Lyles took the same train from Fenchurch Street Station every morning, they made sure to sit in separate carriages and never acknowledged each other. By the end of the First World War, it was clear that the competition was actually hurting both companies, but neither had a clear upper hand. The Lyles had the edge in profitability, but the Tates' output was not to be rivalled. A merger was the obvious way forward. Negotiations began, and for 3 years, Ernest Tate and Charles Lyle tore their hair out in frustration as proposal after proposal was rejected by their respective boards. A deal was finally agreed in 1921. The new Tate and Lyle Company retained both London factories, Tate's Thames refinery in the heart of Silvertown and Lyle's Plaistow Wharf refinery a mile upriver. The management of the two factories, however, remained in the hands of the respective families. The original Tate and Lyle, Henry and Abram, were both long dead by now and had never known the fate of their companies. In fact, they had never even met. The old rivalry didn't die out completely, and from 1937 onwards it was played out in a more friendly fashion on the company's new shared sports ground. There, the workers from Tate's and Lyle's, as the two factories continued to be known by the locals, would compete against each other in football and cricket. The Second World War brought great changes to both refineries, as their workforces became female-dominated for the first time. As men were called up, the management were forced to blur the strict distinctions between men's and women's jobs, with female workers tackling even the most physically demanding and high-status roles, including that of the pan men who boiled up the sugar liquor. The women were thrilled to see their wages go up when they took on such new jobs, but they were still only paid 75% of what their male counterparts had earned. After the war, the men reclaimed their old roles, but a shift had taken place, and the crucial part that sugar girls played in the company's success could no longer be ignored. In 1948, a mixed-sex canteen was built at the Plaistow Wharf refinery, and for the first time, the women were able to eat alongside their male colleagues. Today, after the closure of the docks and almost all of the local factories, much of Silvertown has the feeling of a ghost town. It is overshadowed by the planes taking off and landing at City Airport, whose runway cuts between the Royal Albert and King George V docks, and the looming concrete viaducts of the Docklands Light Railway. Many of the old Victorian terraces have been replaced by blocks of council flats, and the pubs, shops and cafes that once lined the North Woolwich Road opposite the Plaistow Wharf refinery are all gone. The close-knit neighbourhoods and the way of life that once thrived there have vanished and can never be recovered. Tate and Lyle is unusual in having retained its Silvertown factories, although from the late 1960s much of the Plaistow Wharf refinery was demolished as its sugar refining activities were wound down. Many loyal workers took redundancy rather than accept a transfer downriver to the Thames refinery. Even there, the company now employs only a small fraction of its former workforce, and the jobs once done by the sugar girls are all performed by machines. Tate and Lyle has long since stopped being a family firm, and in 2010 it was bought by an American sugar giant. However, the legacy of its original founders lives on. In 2006, the iconic Lyle's Golden Syrup tins were officially recognised by the Guinness Book of Records as the oldest brand in Britain. Meanwhile, the philanthropic work of the Tate family is remembered in the libraries and art galleries that bear its name. But the contribution of those ordinary young women who played such a central role during Tate and Lyle's East End heyday is not widely recognised, and their lives have not generally been recorded. This is the story of those women, the teenagers who left school and gave the best years of their lives to Tate and Lyle. This is the story of the Sugar Girls. Chapter 1. Ethel. On a crisp September day in 1944, Ethel Alleyne stood outside Tate and Lyle's Plaistow Wharf refinery, looking up at the giant gate with its elaborate wrought iron and shining white clock. A wiry, frizzy-haired girl with light brown skin and keen dark eyes, she was wearing her best dress for the occasion, black, with red trimmings. In one hand she clutched her headmaster's testimonial, already proudly committed to memory. Ethel's attendance has been regular and punctual. She is a very willing, cheerful girl, always ready to give her best. Her neatness and tidiness and general attention to detail are very pleasing. I can recommend her to any employer as a conscientious worker. At 14, Ethel had never been inside a factory, but she felt as if she'd been preparing for this moment all her life. She had grown up in the heart of Silvertown and was used to living in the shadow of the Sugar Mile, the stretch of colossal factories that ran between Tate and Lyle's sugar and syrup refineries. The factory life was in her blood. Her mother's family had lived in the area for generations, working in Kayla's jam and marmalade factory, and her grandfather would tell anyone who would listen that he remembered when Silvertown was little more than a marsh. From a hut on the left of the entrance emerged a fierce-looking man in the smart, military-style uniform of a commissionaire, his navy blue tunic buttoned up to the collar and the silver buttons gleaming in the sunlight.
"Yes, darling."
Ethel drew herself up to her full height and did her best to hide her nerves. "I'm here about a job," she told him.
"In here."
He gestured for her to follow him into the little hut. Inside, Ethel stood anxiously while a man in a white boiler suit glanced over her testimonial and noted down a few details on a form.
"Essiflor, I think," he told her briskly. "But the surgery will need to check you out first. I'll get a girl to take you."
Before long, a smartly dressed young woman who looked to be in her late teens arrived at the door.
"Essa girl?" she asked Ethel as they stepped out of the hut.
I think so," Ethel replied, "but I'm not sure what that means."
"Oh, Essa of Stuttgart make the sugar packing machines, but we try to keep that quiet these days. Come on."
The two girls headed into the refinery. Ethel was quite unprepared for the sight that met her eyes. She knew that the factory was big, but seeing it up close from the inside was another matter. Ahead of her, slightly to the right, the enormous grey brick hulk of the Hesse building towered over her. At its base, a team of boys and burly-looking girls were standing on a raised level open to the yard, loading up great haulage lorries with ton-weight boards of sugar bags. To her left, another large building housed the factory's bar and recreation room, and in front of her, wagon tracks crisscrossed all over the ground, branching off straight ahead towards the syrup shed where the Lyle's golden syrup tins were filled. Underneath it was the blue room, where the sugar bags were printed, and beyond was the can-making department where girls produce the famous tins. In the distance, she could make out the looming white concrete of the pan house, where sugar liquor was boiled into crystals, and next to it, an even taller set of chimneys from the boiler house. Ethel searched in vain for the shining curve of the Thames, where the boats of raw sugar were unloaded. She knew it must be at the far end of the site, but through the jungle of warehouses in between, she couldn't catch a glimpse of the water. As the two girls hurried across the yard, a musty, malty smell of damp sugar hit them in a cloying wave, shortly followed by another, ranker odour that almost made Ethel retch. She knew what it was, but tried her best not to think about it. The pile of rotting carcasses just the other side of the factory wall at John Knight's soapworks. It was a smell that every Tate and Lyle worker had to learn to ignore. In the surgery, a young nurse listened to Ethel's heart, took her blood pressure, and checked the movement and strength of her limbs. Then she carefully scoured her frizzy hair for nits before passing her fit for service. Ethel followed the other girl back towards the dark grey Hesse building, on the outside of which a black metal staircase zigzagged up all 8 floors.
"It's a long way up, but you get used to it," said the girl as they began to climb the steps.
As they neared the top, Ethel was beginning to lose her breath, so she was relieved to spot a sign that read, "Small Packets." They went into a cloakroom, where Ethel deposited her coat and bag, and then threw a pair of double doors onto the factory floor. The noise as they stepped through the doors was overwhelming. The large room echoed with the rattle and grind of a dozen machines, huge lumps of iron around which stood teams of young women. Over the top of the noise there was music blaring out, and some of the girls were singing along. They went up some stairs to an office on a mezzanine level, and as the door clicked shut behind them, Ethel was aware of a blissful quiet settling around her. The girl left her in front of an impeccably tidy desk, on which stood a little sign, "Ivy Bachelor, Forelady." Behind the desk sat a tall, upright woman in a long white coat. Her brown hair had evidently been expertly styled, and her nails and makeup were immaculate. "Take a seat," she said calmly, gesturing to a chair on the other side of the desk. Ethel did so, sitting up as straight as she could. She was determined to make a good impression. The forelady looked at her kindly, reached for a form from a pile on her desk, and took down Ethel's name and address.
"Is there any particular reason you want to work at Tate and Lyle?" she asked.
Ethel hesitated. She had dreamed of working at one of the giant sugar factories ever since she was little, and her dad had taken her to the Tate Institute, the social club opposite the Thames refinery. They had gone to see a show laid on for local residents and employees, and Ethel had been transfixed, not merely by the dancers on stage, but by the glamorous young women who thronged the hall watching them. They were the factory's female workforce, and her dad had told her they were known as the Sugar Girls. She felt self-conscious at the idea of telling that story, though.
"I only live down the road," she offered instead.
Ivy Batchelor laughed gently. "No, I'm afraid we can't offer you a uniform at present, unless you have ration coupons to spare. But we should be able to lend you an apron for the day." She rummaged around under the desk and came up with a rather worn-looking pinny. "Your hours are 8 to 4 Monday to Friday and 8 to 12 on Saturday. You're allowed half an hour for dinner and 2 toilet breaks a day. Any questions?" Ethel shook her head. "Good. Then Mary will see you to one of the machines." As if on cue, a stern-looking woman with dark hair marched through the door of the office and gestured for Ethel to follow her. She was Mary Doherty, one of the department's 3 supervisors known as charge hands.
"This way,"
she commanded. Ethel jumped up and followed her onto the floor. At each machine, paper bags were moving along a conveyor belt and being filled with sugar from a chute overhead. They were then sealed with a spurt of glue, and a girl took them off the belt, piling them up ready to be packed. A packer then pulled down a sheet of brown paper and flipped the bags onto it in layers until they had made up a parcel, sealing it like an envelope with a bit of cold water and heaving it onto a board. When a ton weight of sugar had been assembled, it was taken away on a trolley down to the lorry bay. In charge of each machine was a driver, who paced around keeping an eye on everything. The girl's various repetitive movements combined to give the impression of an elaborate ballet. Mary led Ethel across to a machine at the far side of the room, where a woman with giant hands was parcelling up the sugar bags.
"This is Annie Stout," Mary told Ethel. "She'll show you how the packing is done."
She strode off across the floor and back up to the office. Ethel noticed that on the ends of Annie's fat fingers were 10 little paper thimbles.
"You'll need some of these," she told her, "or your hands will be bleeding by lunchtime."
Without once interrupting her flow, she instructed Ethel in how to make her own thimbles from some spare scraps of paper. Then she stood back and let her have a go at packing. At first, Ethel found it hard holding several bags at once in her hands, but if she applied enough pressure to the sides and lifted them in a clear, fluid arc, twisting them rapidly before they had a chance to slip, she found that she could manage it without dropping any.
"That's it," Annie told her approvingly.
After a while, she leaned in close, and Ethel thought she was going to offer to take over the job again. But instead, she whispered something in her ear.
"Got any sweetie coupons you don't want, darling?"
"Any what?"
said Ethel, taken aback by the question. Annie whispered more emphatically.
"Ration coupons!"
"No, sorry,"
Ethel replied briskly. She screwed up her face as if focusing intently on her work and tried to avoid catching Annie's eye. Before long, Ethel's wrists were aching from flipping layer after layer of sugar bags, and she was beginning to wonder whether it was too soon to ask for one of her 2 toilet breaks. Just then, there was a sudden dimming of the lights, and a voice crackled out from the loudspeakers which were stationed around the room.
"All personnel to shelters, please! All personnel to shelters!"
The driver of Ethel's machine swiftly pulled a lever and the whole mechanism ground to a halt. Carefully, Ethel laid down the bags in her hands to complete a layer and then looked up, hoping that Annie would tell her what to do next. But Annie was gone, lost in the stream of bodies filing in an orderly but hurried fashion towards the exit. 4 years after the start of the Blitz, Tate and Lyle had got evacuations down to a fine art and could gather nearly all 1,500 of their wartime workforce into shelters within the space of 4 minutes. A command centre, under the can-making department, received signals from the National Telephone Exchange,
and 4 spotters permanently stationed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.